book. I couldn't set it down. Father, not too many things gets me out of bed at 4 o'clock in the morning. But once I got started on this book, I couldn't leave it down. Exciting.
Well, that's terrific. One of my colleagues at John Carroll told me that it gallops. So it.
That's right. It moves. It really does.
And I think it's been described as a thriller. And in between the exciting moments, I hope there is some really good
content. And the ending is different. We won't talk about that too much. The ending is different.
The ending is surprise. Surprise.
Yeah, indeed. Surprise. Surprise. And it's just about got a bit of everything into it, even about the sharpshooter, the sniper from the war.
I know my friends have asked, how did you become so familiar with military arms, you know, and ordinances? So I had to do a little homework with that. That's some.
But this, I want people though to understand, this is a novel.
Yes, it is.
Right. That's important to point this out. What about the inspiration for it? Did it just come to mind?
Good question. I had written a few nonfiction books, and they did pretty well from a market standpoint. I've been hearing for some time that the best way to get a message across very often is through story. And I thought, how about telling a story? I had this plot in mind for some time, and I thought I would take a chance and move into fiction. And as you pointed out, it's kept some people up at night, and I'm very grateful for that comment. It's won a few awards, so.
Nellie, my wife Nellie read it, and one thing she said to you, she says, I'm not so sure I'd give this to my mother if she was alive to read.
Well, I've had some blue-haired grandmothers say I've really enjoyed it. There is not much R-rated material.
No, there isn't. A few pages, but she picked them out anyway, you know. She probably read them over a couple of times.
And she underlined them.
Yes. I want to deviate from the book for just a minute now. For our listeners that have never had not heard of you, and just about everybody has, how many years have you been a priest now?
51 years now.
You already talked about how you got into the writing, you became a writer, we talked about that. But the first book you did, The Changing Face of the Priesthood. Now, you were on the program, I think it's about 8-9 years ago, and we talked about it. In fact, I got the autographed copy. I loaned it to somebody and they never gave it back to me, you know.
That happens, yeah.
Yes. That book was translated into how many languages?
8 languages, including Korean.
And you traveled extensively talking about that book and the subject matter in that book, didn't you?
That book, yes, led to a number of invitations. I've been able to speak in Australia, New Zealand, England, of course, Ireland a number of times.
Now, what was the most recent trip you had to Ireland? What did you talk about?
Actually, I was at Maynooth Seminary in Ireland just about 5 years ago. Wow. Fascinating, fascinating seminary that is 15 miles west of Dublin. It was built in the late 18th century for 700 seminarians. When I was there in about 2007 or 8, maybe a little bit later, there were 70 seminarians in a seminary built for 700.
Mm-hmm.
I think today there are about 60 mm-hmm. seminarians there. And this is the only seminary in Ireland. So the situation of the vitality of the church in Ireland is precarious, I think. And
yes,
it's not that different from the church in the U.S.
I think it's worse there, though.
You know, it could be, Jerry. I think the clergy sexual abuse scandals were simply devastating to many Irish people who felt their faith was so dear to them.
Such a pillar of every community.
And that the anchor of many villages and towns happened to be the clergy.
Mm-hmm.
My
dad was a school teacher, and his boss, the manager of the school, was the parish priest. He could not do anything without getting permission from the parish priest. And that's the power of the church in Ireland in those days.
Yeah. And we've seen a radical change in that attitude. You know, I think there's still respect for the clergy in Ireland, but it's not the absolute kind of whatever Father says goes type of thing anymore.
No, I know in the village that I grew up, there was one person in the village that didn't go to church, a man, an older gentleman. And the general opinion of all of the neighbors was, he has to be crazy. There's just something wrong with him. He's mentally disturbed just because he didn't go to church.
You know, in 1965, when I was ordained, about 70% of Catholics went to church every Sunday. I think in Cleveland now it's about 22%, which is still higher than what it is in some areas of Ireland. So
I know several people, older people, that don't go to church anymore. When I left Ireland, we were all young. When I was 19 years old when I left, and just about everybody went to church on Sunday. You didn't have the Saturday masses then, but you had Sunday masses. But when I make my annual trips now, I can't help but notice the same people that I knew were loyal churchgoers. They don't go to church anymore. They go once in a while, they go to a funeral, or they might go at Easter time. Very similar to what we see here, actually.
But, Jerry, I want to add that the fact that a large percentage of Catholics in Ireland and here in the United States aren't going to Mass every Sunday, that doesn't necessarily mean that they've lost their faith. Mm-hmm. I think that many people who are not going to Mass every Sunday might deeply believe that Jesus is the Christ and that the Catholic Church has a long wisdom tradition to it. But I don't think Catholics believe that if you miss Mass on Sunday, on a given Sunday, it's always a mortal sin. You know, the Church has used mortal sin, I believe, at times to motivate people to do what is necessary. Still, we need to take very seriously the sign of the times that many Catholics aren't practicing their faith the way they did when you were a young man.
Well, does that mean that it was a sin then, but it's not a sin now? Certain things.
Well, now we're getting into my next novel, which is entitled Mortal Sins. I certainly think sin is a reality, a sad reality. But I think to, for example, tell someone if you were to eat meat on Friday years ago, that was a mortal sin.
But that was a commandment of the Church, not more than
that. That was
a
commandment of the Church, and so is Mass on Sunday, a commandment of the Church.
Those can be changed, right? Church teaching.
The essence of the commandment, I think, is fundamentally sound. I think it's hard for us to be faithful Christians unless we worship. Mm-hmm. So I think the commandments of the Church are really solid. My issue is, what kind of a penalty do you assign to it? When I was ordained a priest didn't say his breviary, he committed a mortal sin. So I'm kind of giving away the next story.
Yeah, that was what we used to call the priest's office, wasn't it?
Yes, the office.
The office we used to refer to, American refer to as the breviary, is it?
Yeah, or the breviary, the office, liturgy of the hours. Yeah.
But the original Ten Commandments, what we all believed was, if you broke a commandment then, you committed a mortal sin. Do you still do that today?
Well, I think, the commandments,
the Ten.
The Ten Commandments that are part of our scripture.
Right.
I'm not sure every breaking of the commandment was a mortal sin. Honor your mother and father. I think sometimes you could be disrespectful. My father, by the way, had three kind of laws for his sons. One was, never let me catch you being disrespectful to your mother, okay? And then, never hold a grudge, and never run from a fight. So I think he was kind of reflecting the Ten Commandments there. You know, in the Hebrew Bible, in Deuteronomy, a son who disrespects his father was to be stoned to death. Woman caught in adultery, or a man caught in adultery. I mean, talk about mortal sin. We'll take a look at the penalty there. No, the Ten Commandments are sacred and to be regarded and respected deeply. But
you can't self-interpret the Ten Commandments, can you?
No, you can't self-interpret the Ten Commandments, but you need at the same time to take the tradition seriously and then pay attention to your own conscience. I have a friend who goes to Mass every day of the week, but not on Sunday.
Oh, that's strange.
Now, is he strange? Is he committing a mortal, deadly sin when he doesn't go to Mass on Sunday? I'm not sure. I think there's some people that are very respectful overtly to mm-hmm. their parents, but harbor deep negative feelings inside. The whole business of sin, first of all, it's real. I'm not one of the people that feel that we need to get rid of sin. But Christianity is not fundamentally a legal system. Pope Benedict XVI, God bless him, said, Christianity is not a law to be obeyed, but a presence to be seized. Now, by that, he didn't mean don't keep the commandments, of course. He meant, you know. But for Catholics, religion is often doctrine and morality. Those are two fundamental elements of the faith. But there's more to being a Christian and a Catholic Christian than believing in the Ten Commandments and church teaching and behaving and accepting the doctrines of the church. Those are foundational, they're fundamental. That should lead to a transformation of how you live. It's like being in love. Take the image of romantic love.
Oh yeah, there they are right across the bridge.
And I'm looking at our two very handsome musicians who just blew me away with their music. God wants us to fall in love with life. That means with God, with creation. So the commandments are fundamental. The church's teaching is fundamental. Leading a moral life is fundamental. But it's more than that. It's a way of living your daily life in love with the mystery we call God.
Well, wouldn't it the perception also have something to do with whether you committed sin or not? Because I was always taught there was a few things that...
Three conditions of mortal sin.
That was clear knowledge, full consent...
Of the will, yeah.
And what was the other one? I can't remember what the other one was. There was three anyway. But if you didn't have those, you really didn't commit a sin. And what... It leads me to my next question. We say people that get divorced, two Catholics that get divorced, and they go off and they marry somebody else without the benefit of an annulment. Are they living in mortal sin?
I don't think we can say yes or no to
that
question. I don't
think so either, because it's up to what their perception is, isn't it?
It's really not just their perception. They need to take into account, I believe, the long wisdom and insights of the church. But when a couple finds that a marriage doesn't work, it's one of the most painful things, I think, of an individual experience. So they separate. They feel that their marriage has died. Mm-hmm. And should they remarry without, as you said, an annulment, I think maybe we have to humbly say, I don't know if they're living in sin.
If they don't believe they are, if they say, I don't think I'm doing anything wrong, I fell in love with this woman or this man, and I think I'm doing the right thing, are they? It used to be the old days.
Again, I think
the
issue,
priest would condemn them from the altar in the old days that I remember.
You're right, and here in the States too. But the real issue isn't whether they are living in sin or not, because who can ultimately decide that? I think the real issue is, are they trying to be the man and the woman that they feel God wants them to be? I know for some people this is too vague, too soft, and we need to get back to a clear, hard rule. But I think our present Pope, Francis, has given us a new way of looking at the church's traditions, and the church's laws.
Do you think there's a liberalization going on in the church now?
depends on what you mean by liberalization. I would say the church is becoming more authentic, because if you say the church is fundamentally law and doctrine, it's more, much, much more than that. I think we're looking at leading the Christian life not so much from the perspective of the commandments. You two are commanded to love each other. That sounds silly. You don't need a church commandment to say love each other. You want to say, I can't help it. You know, I love this person. I have to go to Mass on Sunday, not because there's a commandment that says I need to go to Mass on Sunday. I cannot not go to Mass on Sunday. Something happens there. I'm with people who share my faith. I'm encountering somehow the mystery of God. And for Catholics and the Eucharist, you touch the divine, and the divine touches you. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the challenges I see. Is the church becoming more liberal, and by that many people say more lax? We're just getting too free and easy with God's love.
And that's what a lot of conservatives in the church are fighting the problem with the new pope, isn't it?
Some traditional Catholics are scratching their heads when the Pope says, God is a God of love and mercy, and who am I to judge the state of a person? See, we can never judge even our own state of soul. We hope that we are in communion with God. So I think Pope Francis is taking us back to our roots and to the gospel, which is not a legal document, nor is it even a dogmatic document.
How would this pope, would you say, compare to Pope Pius XII? He was very conservative, wasn't he, XII?
I would say it was a different age at that time, and
yes.
I don't know if we used the terms 50s, conservative and progressive at the time. I think Pope Pius XII was kind of a, don't mean to be disrespectful to him, a law and order pope. Things were kind of black and white, true or false, good or bad. And I think Pope Francis, obviously he's in line with Pope Pius XII, I think Pope Francis is saying it's more than true and false, good and bad, right and wrong. That God's mercy is there, and there are some people that objectively, quote, are living in sin, who might be holier than the people that go to Mass every day.
Mm-hmm. Oh gosh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. I think Francis is saying, be careful to judge individuals. You can judge behaviors. The abuse of your spouse is wrong. The abuse of your children is wrong. Cheating in business is wrong. So we're not backing off on saying what's right and wrong, but what we're, I think, appropriately doing is backing off from saying you're a sinner and you're not.
Yeah, I would say, though, that civil law, as we know it, in the world today is based on maybe on the Ten Commandments, because if you did everything in the Ten Commandments, you would never do anything wrong.
No, I disagree with you, Jerry.
Do you?
Because there are some things the Ten Commandments don't really incorporate and embrace.
Such as?
An attitude of bigotry, an attitude of self-righteousness.
But wouldn't that be covered in one of them? I don't know which one it would be covered in. But
yes, you could probably link them. But no. See,
it's just like the Sixth Commandment. There's a whole series of events in the Sixth Commandment that are comprised of the Sixth Commandment. It's not just about adultery alone. There's dozens of things that are associated with the Sixth Commandment. Am I right?
We Catholics, we specialize in the Sixth Commandment. I mean, we have
looked at
human sexuality from every angle you could look at it. In fact, I just read a wonderful Irish writer, Sean Fagan. He recently died. Sean Fagan wrote a number of books. And he was listing all of the areas in which you could commit a mortal sin when it comes to the Sixth Commandment, and one of them was, it's a mortal sin to watch animals mate.
Oh my goodness, I'd have an awful lot of trouble. I grew up on a farm.
Jerry, I hate to break this news to you, but he said it's okay. Oh, it's okay if the animals are a distance away.
Get your corns on our farm.
So, See, for some people, Christianity is the Ten Commandments, and that would be the same for one of our Jewish brothers and sisters. I'm trying to say the commandments are fundamental. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to say church teaching, our doctrines, are fundamental. But I think you can keep the teachings and accept the doctrines and be a pretty mean son of a gun.
Mm-hmm.
You know, self-centered, self-righteous. Wish more people were like me. I go to church, pay my taxes. I keep the commandments.
Like the Pharisees, huh?
Uh-huh. And I think Jesus was pretty hard on people who thought they were better than others.
Yes, you know? Yeah. I know we've deviated a little bit from the book, I want to play a song program. I think it's about 8 years ago when you wrote this book that really got a lot of attention. It was called The Changing Face of the Priesthood, but he has a wonderful novel out now, which I couldn't put down. I would have recommended. Believe me, if you get this book, I got mine on Amazon. I couldn't wait for him to come in here to get it off him for free. But I want you to sign this one, Father, for me. I want you to sign this one. I bought it from Amazon, but nevertheless, if you can sign it for me. Brian Bigley. Here's a question. We're going to bring him into the conversation here.
I don't even know,
Brian, if you're a Catholic, Protestant, Lutheran, Muslim, or what. I have no idea.
I'll keep you wondering.
Go ahead and ask.
So I was just fascinated by the discussion. I think it's a really great conversation to have in the first place, just to bring up the subjects to talk about, which is the beauty of radio and the beauty of living in this country, isn't it? Something that the Pope said, Pope Benedict said, and I was reminded of something that I read that he said, which was that the Western civilization is currently, and I'm paraphrasing, of course, is currently in decline due to the spread of moral relativism. So my question would be, regarding the current Pope, is he implementing doctrines or procedures or whatever it is that are relativistic in nature? Because if they are, I would have a problem with that. I'm not going to pass judgment on him, like you were talking about before, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
If he was implementing relativistic doctrines, then that seems to me to be something that would bring down the integrity of the church. So I'd be interested to see what you have to say.
There you go.
Brian, thanks for that question. I think it's really significant. Pope Benedict the 16th said, you know, that Western civilization is in trouble. We're really becoming relativistic. Everything is kind of soft, and if you feel this way, fine. If I feel this way, fine. If you think it's okay, good for you. If I think something is not okay, Pope Francis is not contributing at all to this kind of relativism. He's very clear on traditional church doctrine and traditional church morality. What he's suggesting is that there's something beyond the objective behavior in people. And so his focus on God's love for us, God's mercy for us, is perceived by some people as a kind of relativism. I think Pope Francis is trying to say, you know, believing in God is important. I think a lot of people believe in God, but what they find more difficult to believe in is that God loves them personally. I can say to many people, do you believe in God? And I think 90% of the people would say, I believe in some kind of mystery, transcendent reality, call it God. Does this God know you and love you? I think sometimes we're taken back by that. And this is what Pope Francis is trying to get through to us, that Christianity is a faith tradition of love, compassion, community, and mercy. Well, then who's in and who's out? Some people get a little nervous when they hear Pope Francis saying that. They would like to know who's right and who's wrong, who's in the church and who is outside of the church. And so the focus on compassion, mercy, regard for the poor, and not only regard for the poor, but trying to live in a way that we actually address the poor. Some people say, well, that's relativism. That's, you're softening down, watering down Christianity. I think Pope Francis is doing just the opposite. He's saying, you have no idea how challenging it is to be a disciple of Jesus. Because Jesus not only wants you to behave and believe, he wants you to be a person who contributes to the mystery we call communion. And he's interested in your attitudes, what's in your heart, as well as your behaviors and what you call to be your creed, what you say in the creed. By the way, I'd love to see the creed introduce a new statement. I believe not only in God, but I believe that God loves me, my sins notwithstanding. Boy, that blows me away. Now there are people who say, don't say that, because then people are just going to go out and do whatever they feel like doing. Yes, you can always abuse the truth of the gospel, but anyway, Brian, thanks for that.
I hope you're right.
I hope I'm right, too. I hope I'm right, too.
Yeah, no, thanks for the conversation.
You're welcome, Brian.
Father Don, worldwide, is the church sound? Do you think it's sound? Does the future of the church look sound to you?
Well,
the Catholic Church, I mean.
Yeah, how it looks to me really isn't that important, but let me try to get to your question. If you want to look at the Catholic Church from the standpoint of practice, are people practicing their faith, you could say that in Europe and, of course, Ireland and England and the United States and developed countries, we have a lot to be concerned about, because church practice certainly has diminished, and we should take that very seriously.
Oh, that's what I'm asking.
But I think the Holy Spirit is with the church, and so the church is going to be alive and well, in spite of hypocrisy, corruption, some kind of decadence throughout the ages. But if we want to look at the church from the world perspective, the church is flourishing, especially in Asia. There are places where the church, we can't build seminaries fast enough and convents fast enough. So overall, I think the church is alive and well, and the church has a mission. And I think that mission is to bring gospel values, especially in the area of social justice, nuclear war, globalization, ecology. I mean, the church has a mission. And I believe that the church will always struggle to be faithful to that mission. Sometimes we do it better than other times. But I think the church is alive and well in spite of what we see as concerns in Europe, in the United States, and in the developing countries.
Now, you know, it used to be that Ireland supplied a lot of the priests to the world, actually, especially to the third world countries, but now seems to be the opposite. Ireland is supplying very few priests, and the third world countries, they seem to be supplying the clergy. Is it because Ireland has become wealthy, and now at the third world countries, is that where the strength of the church is, in the poverty of some nations?
Well, that's an interesting question, because I think sometimes the more economically successful we are as a Catholic people, the more our young men understand all of the different opportunities they have and ways of living their lives. When I was a young boy, to be a priest in my Catholic world of Newburgh, Holy Name Parish, and to have a son a priest, there was more pride and status in that
Irish mother's ambition was to have a son a priest.
Yeah, than to have a son who is a judge or a physician or an attorney. So, yeah, we're scratching our heads and saying, now, why are the seminaries, many of them anyway, in the countries of Africa and in Asia, South America, some parts of South America. What's going on there? We have to pay attention to that. Maybe the church flourishes when it is both poor and economically successful at the same time. I don't think we need to say we need to sell all of our stock, you know.
Yeah, but I do find though that people are inclined to gravitate to the religion, whether it be Catholic or Protestant, in times of trouble, if there's a famine or if there's some great tragedy, people seem to gravitate to it. Is that right?
Well,
seems
sure.
Seems that way to me.
Sure. I think in some of the most secular countries of Europe, if there is a tragedy of some kind, people who have never been in church for years all of a sudden are going to church or praying.
Right.
And that's human enough. I think, you know, life is difficult. It's tragic at times. I think we're wired in such a way, Jerry, that we have an impulse for spirituality, for religion, for religious ritual. And so maybe this is simply a period in the West where the influences of secularism have so affected us that there has been a significant change in practice. Mm-hmm. But if our faith is real, then we're going to, I think, mature in our faith and also practice our faith.
Mm-hmm. Could I get back to the book again? Let's get back. The name of the book is called Master of Ceremonies, and it's a novel by Father Don Cozzens. He doesn't call himself Father on the book, just calls himself Don Cozzens. And, of course, most of us in Cleveland know him as that, Don Cozzens. And we knew your brother Jimmy very well. Jimmy owned the pub over on Broadway Avenue, didn't he, for years?
Yes, he did. Thanks for mentioning, Jerry.
He's a great person. But let's talk about the book here. Mirroring the male character of the church leadership, most of the characters in this book are men. Yet you have several strong women in the story. Can you describe them? And one of the women that I remember in this was Margaret Comiskey. She really shocked that congregation, didn't she?
Well, thanks for mentioning the two women, Jerry. I just fell in love with these two women. Margaret Comiskey, who is a secretary in the chancery of the Archdiocese of Baltimore. She has a dear friend, Ella Landers, who worked in the State Department and was a covert CIA. And these two women really are at the heart of the novel. Even though, as you pointed out, most of the characters, since we're dealing with bishops and priests, are men. Now, Margaret Comiskey.
Again, a fictitious character. It's important to remind people this.
Oh, they're all fictitious. All fictitious.
Yes. You didn't know any of these people.
Margaret was heartbroken when she discovered that her nephew, who was like her son, was abused. And it really created a crisis in faith for her. And she fell into a mindset of revenge. But of course, the novel is about revenge. It's about betrayal, but it's also about redemption. At one point, Margaret, and I don't want to give too much away, says
to her dear friend, "You want people to buy this book."
Well, thank you. He says to Ella, "You know, I'm not going to say what I was just going to say, because I hope they'll go out and buy the book. But these are two remarkable church women who have a deep and mature faith and who love God. So get to know them. They're more interesting than the clergy types."
Mm. Well, how about the Bishop Martin in the book? Now, he appears to be a very honest man, but again, a very kind of flawed also.
Well, Bryn Martin is perhaps the major character in the book, and the title is based on his role as a young priest being a master of ceremonies to the Archbishop of Baltimore. Something happens, and I'm not going to give away what it was, something happens to Bryn Martin when he is a priest that he feels leads to his being named a bishop. He's very critical of clerical climbers that he sees in some of the priests of the Archdiocese, And yet at the same time, he fears that he too might be a clerical climber. He kept his mouth shut at a time when perhaps he should not have. So one of the themes of this book is clerical ambition. It's awfully hard for a priest to even admit to himself that maybe one day I'd like to be a bishop, you know. And so there's no personnel board you can apply to and say, put my name down for chancellor or bishop.
Most of us in the laity would not probably understand that there is that kind of ambition in the clergy, but they're human beings, right?
Well, I had a good friend who's a psychologist say Catholic priests need to, in a sense, sublimate or integrate their sexuality as celibate men. So they have to have control over their sexuality. But he said there's another drive that's as human as sexuality, and that is, I want to say, ambition. Ambition is a tricky concept. If you're willing to climb over people to be a success, then your ambition is not healthy. But if you'd like to be all that you can be, to more or less quote the Army slogan, and you would like to be recognized, how do you go about that? So trying to be recognized often requires indirection. It's not as healthy as it could be, is what I'm trying to say. And thank you for raising that point about ambition. Priests are not ambitious men any more than religious women, as sisters are ambitious women. There's a part of us, I think, that would love to be noticed and celebrated. And I don't think it's that different from most people. I do think ambition is a particular problem for clergy, but it's a problem for all of us, ordained, vowed, lay people.
And would you say as you get up higher in the hierarchy of the church, that ambition would be more prevalent?
Jerry, I would have no idea. I'm never going to.
You've never been a cardinal.
No, it isn't more prevalent. And I think the bishops that I've been privileged to work with were not ambitious men. And I think most cardinals don't think of themselves as ambitious men. A few, yes, would say secretly, I want as much status and power as I can achieve. But the majority of our high-ranking church leaders are not ambitious people. I think very often they're accused of being power-hungry and ambitious. And they want lives of comfort and ease. Are there some like that? I would say, of course, but I don't think there are many like that.
Who I met one time, I met Cardinal Sean O'Malley. He's from Cleveland here, he grew up here in Cleveland, went to school here. And there was a lot of talk at the time that the last pope was being selected, that he was on the short list to be selected as the new pope. But he's a very humble man, and I don't think he wanted or cared one way or the other whether he was selected. And he's in Boston now, I think, isn't he?
He is the Archbishop of Boston and close friend of Pope Francis. He's one of the members of that cabinet, the College of Nine Cardinals that are...
And when they were selecting the Pope, I remember before the white smoke came up, they said that the new Pope is going to take the name of Francis. And I had heard that Cardinal O'Malley was going to take that name if he was selected. So I said to his friend Pat Donnelly, I said, for sure, your friend Cardinal Sean O'Malley is going to be selected, and turned out that it was Pope Francis. So anyway, another one now. Speaking of church ambition, Cardinal Richelieu of France, when he ruled France, now there was the most ambitious cardinal I ever think in the history of France, for sure. Ambitious church prelate. And he became, he was a soldier before he was a bishop. In fact, he became a bishop at 24 years old, and I think it was around 1582. But he was the one that decimated the Huguenots in France and destroyed them. But he was a cardinal at the time, and he knew that he had, while he thought he had to do it to change the direction of France, but he was one church, prince of the church, that really didn't, he didn't act like we expect bishops and cardinals to act, I suppose.
You know, during the break, you mentioned, Jerry, that you know people that say, I don't go to church anymore, I don't mm-hmm. practice my faith, there's too much hypocrisy, too much decadence, you know, I'm just fed up with it.
I hear that a lot.
You hear that a lot. And I want to say it's important that we don't second guess these people, but it is very possible to let the faults and sins of the church lead a person to say, I've had it with organized religion. I think that's really unfortunate when it happens. If you, as you're doing, read church history, you're going to have countless reasons for leaving your faith. But the church is human. I believe it has the presence of the Spirit, God's Spirit, in a special way. So anybody who has even a superficial understanding of the history of the church, you know, you mentioned our persecution of Protestants and Jews and Muslims. I mean, we have a lot to atone for. The church was slow to condemn slavery.
And the Crusades, of course.
And of course the Crusades, where children and women were slaughtered. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, just as our families have their shadowy characters and we have our own faults to attend to, I hope that people who would say, excuse me, I'm leaving the church because of its hypocrisy, would sit down with a man like Cardinal O'Malley, or sit down with a believer who isn't ambitious. I think God created us for community, and if you try to go it alone as a believer, it's really hard and it's very easy to get really strange. So we need community. We need the church, in spite of all of its faults. But at the same time, there are many, many virtues that we haven't really been talking about.
Great institution. Yes.